morning? Would you turn to the person sitting next to you and give them a high five, keep them awake, maybe for some reason been drifting off? Wow. Awesome. It's great to be here. When I got to the airport in Accra on my way here, I went to the counter to check in. And the lady that was attending to me started asking me questions because I just got a brand new passport. So she was flipping through the passport and was asking me questions. What are you going to do in Singapore? What's your mission in Singapore? And I said, you just said it. That's my mission in Singapore. Then I said, I've been going to Singapore for the last 20 years. That's my second home. So you can understand why I'm going to Singapore. So while she was still questioning me, her supervisor came over and said, hello, Pastor Gospel. And I said, hi. And she said, we have not seen you this year. Have you not been traveling? And I said, no, I've been good, I've been home. And I just realized that from January to February, it just started February, and she's asking me, we've not seen you this year. Then I said, I've not gone anywhere. She said, congratulations. And I was wondering why a staff of an airline that needs to make people travel and get money was congratulating me on not traveling. When people begin to speak to you like that, it means you're doing a lot of traveling. And you have to begin to advise yourself. It's a joy being here. I wouldn't have missed this for anything. I think that what is happening here is exciting. God is doing a new thing. And this morning, He's brought me to share a word with you so that we can get to where God wants us to be. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Today is our Mission Sunday, you've been told by our senior pastor. You've been informed of this well ahead of time. You know what is happening today. If somebody is here who is not aware of what we're doing today, then that person needs to hear this message. Because that is why we are here. You need to really hear this message. If there's any reason why your heart is pumping up, maybe your heart is beating very fast because you heard Mission Faith Pledge, then you also need to hear this message. It means that you are scared and you need to hear the word that will encourage you to put you in the right frame of mind to be able to do what we have to do today. I'm excited about what God is doing today. I'm excited. I'm pretty excited. Why? Because we live in a moment in history that has never happened before. Wonderful things happening all over the world. Very much power being at work. God saving souls all over. When you begin to hear statistics on how people are getting saved around the world, and you hear places like Nepal, you hear places like China, you hear places like Middle East, you talk about Saudi Arabia, and you hear that people are getting saved than any other place, then you know that God is up to something. That this is the moment, this is the time that we will not be able to miss or hold out on. We have to be able to step into what God is doing and be in the flow and work with God for what will be able to transform this world. Hallelujah. So today is a powerful day. It's an outstanding day. If you are also saying, Pastor, well, I hear you, this is Mission Sunday, so what I want to do is just fill the car out and go home. You don't even have to preach. Then you need to hear the message as well, because it means your heart is fixed. And it's going to be very difficult for you to be able to do the right thing. I want you to hear this so that you can encourage yourself. It's a very simple message that God has given me today to share with you, and I believe that God is going to really bless you. Amen? Amen? Amen. What I'm talking on, I have titled it, Ignite Your Faith. Ignite your faith. It pleases God. Ignite your faith. It pleases God. To ignite is simply to set ablaze, to set on fire, to revive, to quicken, to get it going. Ignite your faith. Why do you have to ignite your faith? Because that is the only way we're going to please God. If you and I are going to please God, we have to come to God with a form of faith. We have to come with our faith enlightened. We have to come with our faith stirred up. We can't come to God in a very dull mood or in a very retrieved way and still expect God to bless us or to please God. God expects us to ignite our faith. If there's going to be a way we're not going to hold back on what we're giving to God and how we're going out to reach our world, then we have to ignite our faith. We have to be able to stir our faith up to get into that situation. We have to rise. We have to get to that place. When you read the book of Hebrews, Hebrews chapter 11 verse 4, and that is where I'm going to dwell on today. Hebrews chapter 4, chapter 11 verse 4, the NIV, Hebrews 11 4. I'll be reading that to you. It's also on the screen. It says, by faith, Abel brought God a better offering than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as righteous when God spoke well of his offerings. And by faith, Abel still speaks, even though he is dead. Let me take that again. It says, by faith, Abel brought God a better offering than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as righteous when God spoke well of his offering. And by faith, Abel still speaks, even though he is dead. When you read this scripture and you read the last part that says, even though he is dead, it means that when it comes to a believer that operates in faith, a believer that has his heart stirred up, a believer that has his faith ignited, that person goes beyond death. Death is not a limitation, because Abel was able and is able to still speak even though he is dead. And how was he able to do that? He did that through faith. When we ignite our faith, we are able to go and defy death and go beyond by speaking even in generations to come. Amen? Faith is powerful. When it comes to faith, it does wonderful things. When you read the scripture, you see faith in three different areas. It says by faith, three occurrences. Three times it says by faith in this small verse. Some of the recipients of this book of Hebrew, which is believed Apostle Paul wrote, the early recipients, some of them were people that were entertaining the thoughts that they could live by just obeying rules and regulations. That was the way of doing things, that you will be saved through that. Although they lived in a New Testament, although they lived in a new system, they were still having some kind of entertainment for the past thoughts of the Old Testament ways. They were attracted to the way of worship in the Old Testament, Judaism. They were interested in the old style and the old covenant, the old sacrifices. That was their mindset. So when Paul wrote to these people, there were people within the congregation that were having that mindset. They thought, well, we could be saved by living the old way and doing the old way of things. In so doing, they were trying to say that the sacrifices that Jesus did on the cross, what Jesus did on the cross was not anywhere relevant to what had already taken place. They wanted to go back into the old system, the old way of doing things. And they were making the new covenant that Jesus had inaugurated with his blood a nuisance of no value. So Paul wrote this letter to the church, and as an author, he decided to strike this problem in the church with the subject of faith. In chapter 11 of Hebrew, he mentions this word faith and begins to give a description of what faith is, the great characteristics of faith in relation to the subject that he was dealing with. He was exhorting them on the fact that they have to persevere. They have to be able to stay on. They have to hold on to what they have. They have to endure, persist. So that was what he was addressing them on. He proceeds to set before us some illustrious examples of faith in the Old Testament, the people that live by faith in the Old Testament. So he lists a number of people in the Old Testament, and he uses this to buttress his argument that the people that live under the Old Testament were not saved by living by the law. They were not saved by obeying the law. They were saved by faith. God declared them righteous by faith. Although they lived in the Old Testament, they also lived by faith. And he made the point that it is important to live by faith. Because without faith, it's not going to be possible to please God. Even those under the Old Testament were living by faith. Without faith, God never declared anybody righteous. They never pleased God without faith. It was faith that was the prerequisite. It was the requirement to be able to please God. Faith was important. Faith living rather than keeping the law. And in the New Testament, it's the same faith. We have to have faith in Christ. In the Old Testament, they were looking forward to what God had promised. And the Bible says a lot of them died without even seeing the promise. And we in the New Testament are looking back at what Jesus did on the cross. Bible says that he shouted on the cross, he said, "It is finished. It is finished." He hung on the cross, he had finished the sacrifice, he had finished everything. It is finished. So our faith is centered on Christ. We are looking back. Faith can be two ways. Faith can look forward to something and faith can look backward to something. When you read Hebrews chapter 11 verse 2, it talks about creation. A lot of people believe in evolution and it talks about creation. It said, even believing in creation, you have to use faith. We look back to what God commanded into place. So it is looking back to be able to have that faith and perspective to be able to believe God for what has been put in place. And in the same way, the Old Testament people were looking forward. They were believing God for a day of the promise of God to come to pass. That is the covenant of God. And we are looking back to what is already finished on the cross. This faith is important. When you read verse 6 of chapter 11 of Hebrews 11 verse 6, it says that, "And without faith, it is impossible to please God." Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who endlessly seek him. If we're going to come to God, we have to have faith. We have to ignite our faith. We cannot just come and say, "God, we are here and we do what you want us to do." We have to come in faith. The Old Testament people went to God in faith, and that is how they were able to please God. That was how they were able to be declared righteous by God. We in the New Testament have to go to God in the same manner. Bible says, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, he despised the shame. We look to Jesus. Jesus is our perfect faith example. He is our focus. He is the one that we look to. And that is why today I want to encourage you to ignite your faith. Because if you don't ignite your faith, you will not be able to accomplish anything. You will not be able to have your life become something that is pleasing to God. We have to have faith to be able to please God. If God is going to do anything with us, it has to come with faith. I believe with the track record of VFC over the years in investing and putting our lives into missions, it is likely for us to come to a place where we just come in and get it done. Why? Because we know what is supposed to be done. We just flow with what is happening. And we think it's okay. Why? Because it's something that we've done for a long time. And when you do something for a long time, there is the possibility of falling into that routine mood. You just do it because you have to do it. Today, I want to encourage you are here for a different reason. I don't want you to just do it. I want you to do it because your faith is going to be stirred up. Your faith is going to push you to do something incredible. Your faith is going to make you do something that you've never done before. Why? Because you want to please God. That's why you want to ignite your faith. That's why you want to stir up your faith. Because without that, you cannot please God. What is the point in trying to give and do something and not receive anything from God? We want to receive from God. We want to be blessed by God. We want to be enriched by God. And because of that, we have to come to him in faith. We cannot come in any other way but in faith. We have to exercise our faith. What I want to tell you today is, it takes faith in giving to please God. It takes faith in giving. Giving is not ordinary. Anybody can give. There are all sorts of offerings that go to God. But what pleases God is a giving that emanates out of faith, a giving that comes out of a heart of faith, a giving that comes from somebody whose faith is ignited. If your faith is not ignited and you give, it becomes ordinary. It becomes like any other thing. But when that faith is stepped up, it makes you give and give with the confidence and the boldness, knowing that this is something that I'm doing for God and it's going to please God. God is going to look down from heaven and respect you for the faith that you exercise. For the respect that he gives is out of the faith that you put into place. So we need to stir our faith. The story we've read talks about two people that went to offer sacrifice to God. They went to give an offering. Both of them went giving an offering. Hebrews 11:3 talks about Cain and Abel. They presented their offering before God. Abel's own, when it comes to Abel's offering, Bible says that it was of faith. He gave with faith. But that of Cain was something else. No wonder Abel's offering attracted God's attention. God was attracted to his offering and it pleased God, but that of Cain didn't. The original story is in Genesis chapter 4, verse 3 to 5. Genesis chapter 4, verse 3 to 5. I'll read that to you from the NIV. In the course of time, Cain brought some of the fruits of the soil as an offering to the Lord. And Abel also brought an offering, fat options from some of the firstborn of his flock. The Lord looked with favor on Abel and his offering, but on Cain and his offering, he did not look with favor. So Cain was very angry, and his face was downcast. When you read this scripture, you get to understand why God chose one over the other. Cain brought an offering, but it was with a bat. He brought an offering. This morning, maybe you want to give an offering, but you don't want to give an offering like Cain gave, because that is with a bat. Bible says that it was some of the fruit of the soil. Some of the fruit of the soil. It means that it was ordinary. It was like any other person can give. It was ordinary. It was not any extraordinary offering. It was something that was brought to God, but with no special attachment. He did not come with faith. He just gave. It was normal. It was the sequence, the order of things to do for the day. Oh, today is Mission Faith Pledge. Let me go and give some pledge. Let me just write something. Let me just sign something, because if I don't sign anything, it will look like I'm not involved. It was ordinary. It was normal offering that Cain gave. That is what the Bible says. But the Bible gives descriptive words to that of Abel. Abel went and his offering, first of all, Bible says that it was fat portions. Fat portions. Not normal. This is fat portions. Bigger than usual. What you don't expect. He went in for the kill. He went to surprise God. He went with faith. He gave fat offering. I'm trusting God that today you will give fat offering. You will give something that will be a blessing to the kingdom of God, will be a blessing to missions. I'm trusting God that you go beyond any other thing and give a fat offering. He gave fat offering. Fat offering. Fat portions. And he also says the firstborn. It means that it was prime. It was so important. Not just fat portion, but it was the first. The first. It was firstborn. It was what takes priority in his life. The one that is above everything. That was what Abel gave. He gave fat portion, and it was also firstborn. The author of the book of Hebrews says that after reading all this, you realize why he said all this. He said, by faith, Abel brought God a better offering than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as righteous when God spoke well of his offering. And by faith, Abel still speaks even though he is dead. We will be tempted to hold back if we give like Cain. If our heart is like Cain. Cain was not that bad. Today, we read the story and we make Cain look like some horrific guy, some terrible guy, somebody who had no respect at all for God, somebody who was an outcast. We made him look like he was so negative. He wasn't. He was in a situation that I describe as normal. Normal, nothing extraordinary. He was in there. He went in. The fact that he went to offer sacrifice means that his heart was okay. But it was not what God was looking for. It just didn't measure up to standard. It was somewhere in between. God doesn't want lukewarmness. He wants us to be at the top level. He wants us to be the best in everything we do. And that is why we have to ignite our faith. He went in with an offering that was normal. But God was looking for something better than that. Not just a normal offering. He was looking for something that is ignited in faith. Something that comes out of the extraordinary. Bible says that Abel gave by faith. Abel gave by faith. This morning, are you going to give by faith? Or are you going to just give as to how your senses tell you? You have to give by faith. And giving has to be by faith. That is what God expects from us. Why did Abel give by faith? He gave by faith because Abel's faith caused him to give to God what was not just normal, what was good. He gave God what was good. Are you going to give God what is good? The difference between Cain and Abel was Abel gave his best while Cain gave the rest. One giving his best, one giving the rest. Are you giving the rest or are you giving the best? Because God doesn't want to take. God is not a waiter at a restaurant and he is not there to receive tips. When you are paying your bills and done everything and say, just take, this is what is left, just take this. God doesn't take the rest of your budget. God needs to take the best of your budget. God needs to come first, and that is the heart that Abel had, and Cain did it. He came with the rest, and Abel came with the best. Abel brought an offering that was first. First to a God that is first. Our God is first. Our God is not inferior. He's not secondary to any man. Our God sits on the throne. He is first. God needs to be given the priority in all things. God has to be given the first. So Abel came with his first offering. A first out of the firstborn. The best to give to a God that was first. But when it comes to Cain, he brought secondhand fruits. Secondhand. What was secondary? To give to somebody who was second in his life. So you can just assume who was first in Abel's life, in Cain's life. The person who was first in Cain's life was Cain himself. He pleased himself. He looked and ensured that he was okay. Then the rest goes to God. But Abel had a different attitude. He had a different mind. He had a different mindset and he approached God differently. Abel offered up a more acceptable offering. A more acceptable offering. The Bible says that it was honorable to God. A more acceptable offering that was honorable to God. Are you going to offer God a more acceptable offering that is honorable to him? Because it doesn't have to be ordinary. He brought what was honorable to God. But Cain brought something that did not honor God. No wonder God chose Abel and his offering over Cain. God himself, Bible says, commended Abel and spoke well on his faith. Can you just imagine God commending you? God speaking on your faith. You doing something that pleases God. God get thrilled. He sit up there and say, wow, that's my son. That's my daughter. This is the person that I've been waiting for. And you do something that is not just ordinary. And God get moved by your faith. Can you just imagine what that means? When God himself testifies of a man. When God says what you've done is perfect, is good. When God says that what you've done pleases me. When God begins to enjoy you because of your move in faith. Because you're not holding anything back. God says you are the person and God gets amazed by you. That is what happened to Abel. He did something that moved God. It touched God.
God himself commended Abel and spoke well of his offering. Proverbs chapter 3 verse 9 says that honor the Lord with your wealth and the first fruit of all your crops. It says that we should honor the Lord. If we honor the Lord, it means that we respect the Lord. If we honor the Lord, it means that we admire him. If we honor the Lord, it means that we bring in our all to him. When we do that, it brings joy to the heart of God. God expects us to move in faith. He expects us to ignite our faith. He expects us to give by faith. Abel gave by faith. Are you going to give by faith? As a person sitting next to you, are you going to give by faith? Or are you going to give by your senses? Because we have all these five senses that tells us what we see and all that. But that is not faith. Faith is to begin to see in your soul what the physical eyes and what your flesh cannot feel. Faith is seeing beyond. It's not just normal. It is seeing beyond the normal. That is what faith is. And Abel, living under the Old Testament, was able to exercise faith to the tune of moving heavens. And God getting pleased by that. And we can also have that same experience. I also say that Abel gained by faith. He didn't just give by faith. He also gained by faith. He gained by faith. Abel gained by faith. Why do I say he gained by faith? He gained by faith because, one, his offering was respected by God. God was happy with what he had done. It was honorable to God. And because of that, Bible says that he still speaks, although he is dead. The man still speaks to us. His voice is heard among us, although he's dead. There is this instructive speaking case that we have. First of all, we know that from what Abel did, we know that after the fall, God will open door for the sons of men to be able to come to him with a gift, to come to him with a worship. And there was the possibility of God accepting us. Why? Because we see him being accepted by God. It means that the discourse, the intercourse between God and man was not fully cut off after the fall. God gave man the opportunity, the privilege of coming back to him, reconnecting. And it was through giving, having a sacrifice, bringing an offering to God, man was able to reconnect to God after the fall. And his death speaks to us about that, because he stood for his faith and he died for it. So he speaks to us on that. We know that he was a man that gave to God. We also know that if God is going to accept a person and an offering, it has to be by faith. Without faith, God is not going to accept a man and his offering. Our offerings and our person get accepted by God through faith. Without faith, that is not going to happen. And we also know from his death that God wouldn't suffer Abel's death to just be in vain. He would not just let his death be ended. What God has done is he has raised much more, many more people with the same faith that will please God and honor God. And I'm trusting God that you are one of those people, that through faith you will be able to honor God. Amen. God is a merciful God, and God has opened doors for us so that he can bless us. Amen. God is awesome. I read the story of the Russians in 1960. They sent the first cosmonaut into space. And this guy went and circled everywhere in the outer space and came back on Earth, and he had a press conference. And in the press conference, he said that, I searched the heavens and I looked for God and I did not see him anywhere. Therefore, there is no God. And because of the atheistic state of the communist regime, they said, well, we have a scientific proof that God is not in existence, because we sent someone to the moon and the person went to space and the person came back and said, there is no God. He didn't see God anywhere. But it wasn't long. Within an interval of 6 months, something also happened. A man called John Glenn. John Glenn, who later became a senator in the US. John Glenn also went to space. And he circled the place 3 times. And in 3 times, he came back to Earth and he had a press conference. And this is what John said. He said, I saw God everywhere. I saw his presence. I saw his glory in the galaxy. I saw the splendor, his splendor in the universe. I saw his majesty in the stars. I felt him. I saw God everywhere. These are two conflicting reports. The Russian said he didn't see God anywhere. And John Glenn said, I saw God everywhere. Who was telling the truth and who was lying? All of them were telling the truth. The fact is, the Russian was telling the truth from a human's perspective, from his senses, from what he could see, from what he could feel. But John Glenn was speaking out of faith. He could see God beyond his eyes. He could see God from his spirit. He could see God from a different angle altogether. So it's up to us how we see God. This morning, you may be able to see God in your faith giving, or you may decide not to see God in the faith giving. You may decide to see with your natural eye, or you may decide to see with your spiritual eye. We need to see with our spiritual eye. We need to see in faith. We need to believe and trust God to move in an extraordinary way. When you read 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9 to 12, it says that I have not seen, nor ear heard, nor have it entered into the heart of man the thing that God has prepared for those who love him. And it goes on to tell about how God revealed things to us. As believers, God doesn't just want us to see with our natural eyes. He wants us to see with faith. He wants us to go beyond the ordinary. Faith is believing when I don't see it. When you don't see it, you still believe. That is what faith is. Bible says that we live by faith and not by sight. We live by what? Faith and not by sight. I may not be seeing it with my physical eyes, but I may be seeing God in the situation. You have a little card with you. You may decide to see with the flesh, or you may decide to see with your spirit. When you begin to see in the spirit, you begin to see what God is going to do out of your faith giving in the whole world, touching lives, transforming people, bringing people to his glory. God can do powerful and wonderful things through our giving. You need to see God. You need to see him come through, not with your natural eye, but with your faith eye. You need to realize that God